with Alzheimer's. It was a very
unexpected. WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African-American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
A boy's born in hot dive Mississippi, surrounded by for world that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes to scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city.
We on?
Yeah.
Hello, hello again. This is for the second hour, the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Thank you, Baltimore and beyond, for joining us during this second hour. I am Tehma Smith Wilson, an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. The services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property, create or update your will or your deed, or to purchase your ground rent, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to get in on the conversation and you're not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or your comments to 667-334-7242, and we will be sure to incorporate it into our conversation. And if you missed a broadcast, go to YouTube at our podcast and type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up. We would like to thank Dr. Malcolm Myers for coming on during our first hour to give us the effects of marijuana, cannabis, hemp, and CBD on our bodies. It was a very informative conversation. Thank you for your knowledge and your expertise. And once again, if you know a qualified elementary school teacher, Hope Academy is looking for one additional teacher to complete our teaching staff. Baltimore City is a private school educating our people, and HOPE, helping our people excel. Give me a call if you know someone interested at 667-334-7242.
And co-host, attorney Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning again, Baltimore. 410-547-8820 is my number. I specialize in procurement matters and other transactional matters. And again, life is a motion picture, not a snapshot.
All right. And Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, telephone number is 410-669-1738. I'm going to come to Rashid very quickly because he's been holding. But we got a special guest on the line that we need to get in on our conversations. He's called in. Had him on my show on Wednesday, giving some great perspectives of what's going on. and being involved in that affirmative action situation. I know he has a lot to add to it. So, Rashid, I'm coming to you. Sandra, Tammy, and Joe, hold for me, please. Rashid, quickly.
Yes, I'll make it real fast. First of all, good morning, everyone. But I got information for the public out there, because you know car thefts being on the rise in Baltimore City. You know, particularly the Kias and the Hyundais. But my wife, she owns a Kia, so she you could go to any police station. All you got to produce is your ID. And vehicle registration, and you can get a free club for your vehicle.
Oh, okay. All right.
Just for those particular vehicles, because those are the vehicles that have been the most stolen in the city.
Okay. Appreciate that, Rashid.
You're welcome.
Okay. All right. Sandra, Tammy, and Joe, if you hold, we got two lines open, 410-481-1010. But we are so absolutely glad to have with us former co-host on this show. I call him my brother from another mother, and a great colleague to both our attorneys, Tehma and Robert Bob Dashiell. We're talking about Dwight Pettit. Dwight?
Good morning, folks. Good morning. Carlton, good morning. Bob, how you doing, my good friend? Haven't talked to you
in a
long time. And good morning, Attorney Wilson.
Good morning.
Nice to hear your voice.
Dwight, take it out. First of all, thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. You go back with this affirmative action situation. What is your take on what happened with the Supreme Court decision?
Well, the Supreme Court is making horrible decisions as we talk. They're coming out today, this morning, beyond the affirmative action situation. But the affirmative action situation, as you indicated, Carl, I was from the very inception of that. Believe it or not, I was a trial lawyer for the Nixon administration when affirmative action was first created by John Kennedy and then Lyndon Baines Johnson, and we picked it up with the Nixon administration. And one of my first cases was to, in fact, defend affirmative action for the government in terms of the attack of reverse discrimination by white folks. And so what we have now, 53 years later, they have attempted to destroy affirmative action, and this court has basically done that for all practical purposes after they have, the right wing has tried to destroy this for the last 53 years. So it's a horrible decision. It sends the civil rights movement a dark message. It sets us back pre-1964, and it's horrible, and I think we have to look at some ways around this. The easiest way, of course, as you and I talked about, Carlton, would be to enlarge the court. But we have to get Mr. Biden has to get some heart to get in and do something which is against his old established grain beliefs. But that's what's going to have to happen.
What can African Americans do? African American youth, students, parents who are preparing their youth for college, what can they do to make this not a hard blow on their entry to college?
Well, right now, Attorney Wilson, the case that just came down this morning where the Supreme Court blocked the forgiveness program that Biden had put forth, African-American low-income students are going to have a tremendous burden to get to college in terms of not only affirmative action, the consideration that they used to get, because the court had originally the law was they could use as a factor race. Now they cannot do that any longer. And now we know that the $10,000 and the $20,000 based on Pell Grants that was going to be available to them. That's gone also. So what can they do? That's your question. The only thing I can think of this point in time, if we cannot, as a political base, get Biden to move and get some guts and do the right thing and move against this court, then the only thing that we have and the most precious thing that we have is the vote, state by state.
By the way, let me update everybody because it's just I'm just getting across what Dwight is talking about. The Supreme Court has rejected Biden's plan to wipe away $400 billion in student loans.
Right. Right.
Exactly.
So it's a done.
So what will we be voting for? What do you think will be some of the options that we can vote for in the future?
Well, Attorney Wilson, I'm saying that we have sort of slacked off. I wrote a book, Under Color of Law, and we were so busy celebrating our victories. We let the right wing of this nation move upon us through the voice of Donald Trump. And I think what we have to do now is go back to the drawing board, just like the 60s and the 70s, reorganize the community groups, the NAACP, CORE, the churches, and what have you, and begin to target not just the federal government, but the states in terms of state legislatures, state judiciary, state governors. We've got to put the same forces that we had organized in the 60s and the 70s back to work, because what we have to, we're recognizing, Attorney Wilson, that these folks are serious and they're not playing games. And this is a major, major time in American history and a major time for people of color. These people are out to really return us back to slavery if they have the option to do so. And that's what the 24 election is about. That's what the presidential election is about. We lost the House of Representatives. We need to take that back. We are very close to losing the Senate. We only control it by one vote. We have to go back to the state legislatures, the state gubernatorialships. We have to go back to Congress and take the Democratic Congress back to Democratic control. We have to go back and take the Senate back to control and maintain the White House.
Dwight, you use the term "we" a bunch of times in relation to what appears to be politics, as though to suggest that somehow black folk are part of and necessarily or have some control over the Democratic Party. I think that's a fallacy, and I think that we've seen that neither party, Republican or Democrat, has ever established the interests of black folks as being a primary concern, even within the Democratic Party. And to the extent there's been any so-called progress, it's only been in the wake of extreme social unrest. That the Democrats have elected to act, but my view is, quite frankly, maybe organization or return to organization is there. But if we don't clear up, if we don't decide for ourselves what the end looks like, if we don't define for ourselves what the objective is, then we would wind up in exactly the same position. Our problem with the civil rights is nobody ever stopped to say what the world was supposed to look like when we got them. Who's going to be making the decisions? Because the only real issue is who decides, in my opinion.
And
Bob, I would tend to disagree with you. I do think we've made some progress since the civil rights movement in terms of especially the White House. Mr. Obama didn't do everything that I wanted him to do, but he at least responded to a lot of some of our needs in terms of the health programs and things like that. And of course, Bob and Attorney Wilson, I was a very major player with Jimmy Carter, and we did a lot in terms of federal judges and judges of color and female judges, the largest input in federal appointments across the nation, not to mention just the caliber of the government officials. And so we did a lot. I say in my book, you got to remember, a lot of this was interrupted when the Reagan administration came in. And then we had the Bushes. And then we had the situation where this country went for the deep hook and elected Trump in 2016 instead of Hillary. But I do, I mean, I'm with you, Bob, in the fact that we could do more. I expected more and I expect more out of Biden. But right now, if you look at the choices, we as Black Americans or people of color, what choices do we have? All we got is the choice of a conservative Republican Party that has moved totally to the right and let us know that we are not included in their plans. If we are included, we're included as negatives to destroy whatever political powers we have.
Are you saying that as a people, our only choice is between Republican and Democrats?
At this point in time, I don't think we can win as a third party.
I think that is our problem.
I think that when we say we, what can we do as a community? A lot of stuff always points to the political aspect. We can vote. We can, you know, take this into consideration from the Democrats. We could take this into consideration for the Republicans. But this is education and affirmative action. As a community, can we prepare our children that regardless of Democrat or Republican, that they have the education, they have the SAT scores, they have the grades to get into these schools academically without race being a factor? I mean, isn't it up to the community to prepare our children so that when they go knock on a university door, they come equipped with the GPA, the SAT, the ACT, and the knowledge they have to get in regardless of race?
Well, let me answer this, if I may, Attorney Wilson. First of all, let me correct myself. When I'm saying we, I'm talking about the coalition that has been put together in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, which includes women, which includes people of color, which includes Jews, which includes the political coalition headed by whites that we were able to establish, includes gays and what have you. That's that on that. But I was on the Maryland Board of Regents, and so I'm very familiar with the educational system. We have to realize that this educational destruction of our children is not something that just started. What we're seeing here, for example, in Baltimore City, and what we're seeing across the country, and particularly in the state of Maryland, is a movement to withdraw the proficiency of people of color in terms, particularly Black kids. And so these things, we have to ask ourselves, how did we get in a situation like this where we have Black superintendents, we have Black school boards, and whatever, and this goes back to what you're talking about, Bob, in my opinion, how did we allow ourselves to be put in a box so that our kids are not even prepared to be competitive, even if you did not have an affirmative action situation?
Correct.
I think that's what you're referring to, Attorney Wilson.
Yes, I agree with that. So wouldn't it be, you know, there are some things that we can control, there are some things we can't control, and there's some things that's easier to control, especially on a local level. So not saying that we can't do both, but shouldn't our focus and our real determination and the majority of our efforts be on this local level with all the Black superintendents and, you know, education board members and mayor to get our children educated, which has been deteriorating over years, like you said, get them educated so they can compete.
Right. Well,
you know what, Attorney Wilson, and then Bob, go ahead.
No,
I think we can walk and chew gum at the same time. We have to focus all of our powers on the state legislators, the city legislators.
Yep.
Like Baltimore City's in a mess right now, especially with this crime thing. But we also have to focus with the Congress and with the House of Representatives, the Senate, and we have to maintain the White House. We have to do both, all, in my opinion.
Yeah, but I think also we've got to debunk the notion that somehow or another consideration of race as an admission factor is an attack on merit. First of all, we've got to understand who decides what merit is, and the real issue is who decides the admission in higher education has never been one strictly based upon so-called merit. It's never been that. And there's no way to remedy discrimination that's based on race without taking race into account. Now, with respect to public education and so-called preparation, I agree. Our problem there is we've allowed politics to take over public education. And again, mm-hmm. it comes down to the decision of the exercise. The fundamental decision is who decides. And in this country, the only mechanism ultimately that we have for making those decisions is in the political realm, and that is controlled by the vote. And so yes, you can.
You're back to the major part, Bob. The vote.
Yes. I mean, there's no way around. There's absolutely no way. When you talk about changing changing who makes decisions, it's got to be the vote. You know, and our problem as a people is we keep adopting what other people say about us. For example, I don't know who people of color are. When I was coming up, we were called colored people. Right? I don't know who they are. I'm not gonna. And if you're talking about black people, then say that. But I'm not going to accept people of color putting me in the same category with Asians and everybody else non-black because they didn't come here in the holes and ships with chains on them. So they're not the same. And that's our problem. In order to get, let me finish. In order to get legislation passed, the minority business and otherwise, we said we have to admit white women. Look at what that's got us. The majority of dollars under the state MBE program has gone to companies owned by white women and not blacks. We can't approach it the same way we have historically. It doesn't work.
Go ahead, Dwight.
I'm sorry.
Well, I agree with you, Bob, because I had to write those laws when I was with the Small Business Administration, and we had to dilute them.
Yes.
Include Indians, Appalachians, white women. We had to include everybody because the court ordered that we could not, in fact, refer to quotas, or we could not refer to a particular race. And by name, and we had to change everything. It couldn't be for blacks only. And being at that time in the Small Business Administration, I had to watch, you know, as to how we distributed money because so many shams were coming up, people who were claiming a black front, but really owned a white multimillionaire.
Of course.
And so we had to go through that. But we had, the only thing about it, Bob, we had to reach out in terms of the use of color, in terms of trying to establish the political coalitions that we needed. Now, the problems from that, let's use it as an example. Let's talk about Hispanics. You got one type of Hispanic in Florida who part of the Castro regime who think they're white.
Right.
And then you got another part in Puerto Rico and another part in Texas
right.
that have different thoughts about who they are.
Right.
And so we had, and another thing, the gays and so forth, they began to use our energies and our victory and dispersed it for other groups to benefit instead of black
folks. That's exactly right.
So you're right,
right.
Hey, Dwight.
Uh-huh.
Can you hang with us for a while? We got some people on the line, and you haven't been with us for a while, so they may have some questions, but can you hang with us for a while?
Not a problem, Carl.
Okay, go ahead, Tehma.
And so what you and Mr. Dashiell said, I agree with completely. So how in this day and time do we get African-American issues back in the forefront since so many other ethnic organizations and denominations have attached themselves to African American? Is there a way for us to get back into the forefront in terms of what we desire?
Attorney Wilson, the main thing is we do not advocate like we do in 2016. We, you know, regardless of whether you're Democrat or Republican, we stayed home and we allowed that monster to get into the White House mm-hmm. and seize control of this country. Mm-hmm. And so we cannot abdicate. As bad as things are, as horrible as they are, we have to maintain our identities and the coalitions that we need politically, even if other people have to be educated as to why this coalition is necessary to protect their rights as we're protecting ours.
But we had the wrong coalition. Our coalition has to be with people who are economically at the same position we are. We always assumed that poor white folk, that we could not establish coalitions with them because they've been taught that hate everything black, and that being poor white, that they were still better than anybody black. And so we ignored poor white, and we've allowed that separation. That's where the power is. That's where we need the. We don't need intellectual coalitions. We don't need coalitions among the scholars. We need coalition at the people at the bottom.
Okay, we're coming to Sandra, Tammy, and Joe. We got a couple lines open, 410-481-1010. The person that just dropped off, if you want to call back, 410-481-1010. Sandra, you're on the line. Sandra?
Oh, I had to call in. My favorite person is there. Mr. Pettit, how are you?
Oh, wait a minute.
I love that brother.
He got cut off. Wait a minute. Tell him to call back. Hold on. Hold up, Sandra. Go ahead. What were you calling about? Dwight got dropped off.
Oh.
Accidentally.
Oh, I was you're missing the point here. The person who brought this up was really an aging young student. He's the one that felt that black people didn't have the knowledge and the fortitude to go to those exclusive colleges. And he was complaining that, why would you put blacks ahead of the Asians?
Easy.
Ask Mr. Petty about that.
Right. I think what you're referring to and the reason why this was brought up, because when they look at the merit in the test scores, more Asians that met that standard were denied than any other group. So it was if they say we have 100 Asians that meet this test score, but, you know, we're only going to take 20 of them.
Hello?
So we can get other individuals from other races that also have these test scores. And they're saying, no, if we have 100 Asians that meet these test scores, we want all 100 Asians in, you know, regardless of other individuals based on their race also meeting those test scores. So, you know, it's a give and take with anything. That's why I say at the end of the day, instead of looking just at merit, when you admit someone to any institution, you need to look at them as a whole body. You know, what else can they bring to the table other than the merit, other than the race? What kind of life experiences do they have that they can bring to the table? Everything is not based on ABCs and 1-2-3s and skin color. Look at the whole individual as a package.
Okay, Sandra got dropped accidentally. But I hope she could call back if she had something further to say. We got Dwight back on. Okay, Sandra, you can call back. 410-481-1010. We got another line open. 410-481-1010. Let's go to Tammy.
Good morning, Mr. Douglas.
Hello,
Mr.
Tammy.
Pettit, Mr. Dashiell, and Attorney Wilson. Thank you for taking my call. My comment pretty much chimes in on what you all are saying. Mr. Dashiell, you had made a statement, and you had before, about the importance of voting and how we vote. And there are those of us who do vote for different candidates, whether it's within that particular party or another party. The problem is it's not enough of us to vote. And I'll use Baltimore City as an example. I was born and raised in the city. I currently reside in the city. And we'll use the mayor's race. I did not vote for Mayor Scott. I voted for Mr. Wallace. I thought he was the better candidate of the ones that were running. So if you don't have enough people to have, you know, a different pool of candidates, then you're still stuck with the same people. Now, some people may have voted for Mr. Scott because they thought he was younger, you know, he could bring a different perspective, and I have nothing against that. But I think now people in the city are seeing that is not the case based on the circumstances that are taking place still in the city.
Well,
so, you know, it's not that we don't vote differently, as I stated. It's the fact that we don't get enough people to vote that we can get a different candidate that can serve a different purpose or you know, get different results.
Well, I think I agree with you, but it's not just the number of people to vote, but as you indicate, it's the choice you have of who to vote for. Positive.
Correct.
Positive change is never by accident. It's always intentional. So that
right.
so that in order to change or to increase the the number of candidates we have to have a better process for selecting those candidates in the first instance. And we don't do that intentionally anymore in our community. I mean, I came to Baltimore, you had organizations like the West Side Democratic Club, the Third District Democratic Club,
Metro
Democratic Club. We don't have those anymore. They were operated as sort of the clearinghouse. Now, you didn't have to have an endorsement by either one of them to run, but fact of the matter is you knew that if you didn't have the endorsement, you can run, but you probably weren't going to win. And so that discouraged some and encouraged others. Well, we don't have a selection process anymore. We wait to see who decides they want to be mayor and say, okay, well, you want to be mayor, then we're going to choose from those who decided what they want instead of selecting those who we believe should occupy those positions.
Okay.
Well, because those organizations are not in play, as you stated, this is what we have. So it's like either you're going to leave it blank, you're going to vote for one or the other, because you don't have that kind of pool. And when that pool is raised up, it's not enough people that buy in. So that still leaves us at the same space.
Well,
you understand what I'm saying?
I understand, I do. I think we need to challenge each individual voter to be an educated voter. You know, we have people that are presented before us before the election, so that's maybe 6 months, 8 months at the most. And the most that we know about these individuals are what they send out in flyers, what we see on commercials, and what they say at a debate, if they even go to a debate. So we really don't know too much about these individuals who are in the election and who we are voting for. It's up to us as individual voters to do the research, to see who they are, what they believe, what they don't believe, and then vote based on how they align with how we feel. We can't just go on advertisements because everything is going to look great.
And we ought to have punishment for people who seek office and lie to get our votes.
Well, that's true. Now, we're coming to Sandra, Joe, James, Gene, and Diane. And hot off the press here, I want to give this, okay. So, Justice Sotomayor said, Supreme Court is opening the door to racial discrimination and sending the message that we live in a society with social caste. The other thing is, Mayor Scott is naming Deputy DPW Director Richard J. Luna as interim director of the Department of Public Works. Okay? That's straight off the press. Let's go to Sandra. Sorry we got you cut off, Sandra. Go ahead.
I had to call in. My favorite person is there, Mr. Pettit. Good morning, sir. How are you?
Hi, Sandra. How you doing?
Okay. I love you. Love you and respect you, okay?
You too.
And let me say, Mr. Pettit, let's go back. Talk about the agents who are complaining against the black students who's coming to these high-profile universities, and the only thing they have to offer to get in is their race. This is really about the agents complaining about the black students not being qualified to have those positions in those prestigious colleges over top of them. Would you talk about that a little bit, sir? I'll hang up and listen. Thank you.
Well, you know, when I talk about coalitions, as I did earlier, Sandra, the problem was the parts of our coalitions, if you want to include that Asians could have been people of color, they broke off for their own specific gains, in my opinion, and that's how this suit was, generated. In terms of where we are, in terms of our education, this is so devastating because it didn't say the Bakke case knocked out quotas. You can go back to the Bakke case, and the Bakke case knocked out designation of races. All we had left in terms of affirmative action was the fact that you could use race as part of the consideration for admissions, along with cultural factor, intellectual factors, test scores, and what have you. And now when we get to test scores, that's another big thing, because I spent a whole chapter in my book, Under Color of Law, talking about test scores excluding people who, in fact, qualify. So that's a different subject. But, you know, all that the law said is that you can use race as a consideration because race has had such an impact. You got to realize what
what affirmative action was. Affirmative action was declared by the Supreme Court at the time to be of the national interest in terms of diversity. The diversity was necessary because diversity was something that benefited the whole person. And so what Harvard said and what all the other California, what have they argued, that you needed diversity for the round, well-rounded student, and to have the proper liberal arts or scientific education, you needed diversity. You needed for the students to intermingle with other people around the world and other people with other background experiences. And so what they did by taking that away, that now you've just gone to go to the academic side of it in terms of competitiveness, and the Supreme Court turns around and says, you can write an essay and say in the essay, hey, I'm a minority. That's ridiculous. It's, as Justice Meyer said, that's like putting lipstick on a pig. And she was right. And so we have really been devastated. If I'm talking around your question, Sandra, and maybe instead of directly answering it, but we in fact have to understand the devastation that is done to black people and young students and who are coming about are going to have the necessity, not that they're required to go to college, but to have the necessity to be able to have the tools to work with in terms of making a living in society.
I have a question from...
Hold on, because this line is blowing up. Joe, go ahead.
Yeah, how you doing, Carlton Douglas, Mr. Pettit, Attorney Tehma, and Attorney Bob Dashiell.
Good morning.
As being a Dashiell, and me being a descendant of Dashiell, we come from good stock. But anyway, let me say this. Brandon Scott and Wes Moore are handled by people higher up. You see the condition of this city. We see what goes on every day, but he's always talking some holistic approach. Come on now. What can't you mean? We're sad that we can't see the forest through the trees. Brandon Scott is answering to other people. And I guarantee you, once the election's over with him, he's going to be voted out of office. Trust me, those powers that be are going to give him a cushiony job somewhere. And as for Wes Moore, as I said on your show, he is a globalist. He is not a Democrat. He answers to people higher up than him. Darren Muhammad has exposed Wes Moore for who he is. But the problem is, why did you vote for Wes Moore? You only voted for Wes Moore for one reason, because he was black. You didn't look at his track record.
Well, hold it, Joe. I'm not going for that one, because you had a choice of either going Wes Moore or going with a white supremacist who would have hung you by a tree next to anybody. So I'm not going with because he was black. It was white folks that voted for Wes Moore, too.
I think, Carlton, I think you may be referring to the primary more so than the general.
Well, are you talking about the primary or are you talking about the general?
Let me say this to you. When it came to vote for governor, I voted for neither one of them. I said none of the above. I didn't trust neither one of them. I did not trust Wes Moore, and I didn't trust Perez.
I said
I'm not vote for neither one of them.
Who would you have written in if you could have written in the name of somebody who you wanted to be governor? Who would you have chosen?
Hey, Attorney Bob, I would have voted you. I would have voted Tehma. I would have voted Carlton Douglas. Anybody would have been better than Wes Moore or Perez. Anybody could have been better than them. But I'm gonna tell you right now. Look at Wes Moore's track record. Look at his track. He is a globalist. He's not a Democrat. He's a globalist. Like I said, Darren Muhammad exposed him for who he is. And nobody listened to him, but you still voted for him anyway.
Well, let me say this to bring things to full disclosure here. I had Darren Muhammad on my Wednesday show when he came up with this disagreement with Wes Moore about the book that Wes wrote. The other Wes Moore would happen to have been Darren Muhammad's nephew. And he claimed that nobody in black media would have him on, and I brought him on purposely so that he could not say that we did not bring him on, and I brought him on. Of course, you know, what happened after that, the people chose, and they chose Wes Moore. Now, my problem, and Dwight and I talked about this the other day, the only real problem I got with Wes right now is whoever his handlers are or him himself, I got a problem with hey, first of all, you are the new governor. Let's concentrate on the state of Maryland in doing a good job as being the governor that we chose. And don't let your handlers start pushing you for 2028 to be a presidential a person who may be looking at the presidency.
Too late.
It's out there.
Too late.
He was on two national shows today, and we ain't been able to get him on this one yet. Okay? So that's one of the problems I got with him. Let's go to... Tehma.
I have a question from the text line.
Uh-huh.
Race, when affirmative action was in place, was a consideration. It wasn't the end-all, be-all, meaning that a school didn't let someone in and put next to their name because they're black. So can't those other considerations be taken into effect to have the same effect of affirmative action without it hanging its hat on because they're black?
Not if affirmative action is a remedy for discrimination. It can't be. You cannot. It's like saying, can you put out, if the condition results from discrimination. The real problem is the Supreme Court, a decision that we haven't talked about, is that Supreme Court disallowed the remedy to be applied on a class basis. It required, and this goes back to Bakke, Dwight will remember, it required that in order for, and that discrimination could had to be proven on an individual basis. And so that's pretty difficult for somebody alive in 2021 or 2023 to show how they were a victim of slavery that occurred 400 years ago. Knowing that and that nobody could prove that, that pretty much ended the class approach to a discriminatory remedy. That reduced affirmative action to a social program. And once it became a social program, it opened the doors to everybody who could demonstrate in any way that they had been a victim of some kind of social ill.
Okay. Going to James, Diane, Mike, and we got two lines open, 410-481-1010, because we're going to cut it off shortly because we're getting up against the clock. James, you're on air.
Hey, how you guys doing? This is James from Pennsylvania.
Hey, James.
Hey, James.
Hey, how you doing, buddy? In a roundabout way, I'm kind of happy that it happened, and I'm going to tell you why. It's not that I was not for affirmative action. I think it is going to galvanize us because of all the stuff that we're seeing, the same way you're seeing these African nations have become galvanized against Trump, and now they're pushing towards Russia and China, and they're doing that whole thing. I think that's going to do the same thing to us. Us being the original people, we really don't, we don't need help. We don't need to go and ask anybody, but we just need to just do it. You know, we didn't need people back in the 50s and 60s. We had our own town, our own Wilmington, our own Black Wall Street, you know? So that's where I'm at on it. And they don't, look at what happens in prisons with the credit scores. You know, they use all this stuff against us, and they still lock us up when they don't lock other people up. So, I mean, it's just a bunch of confusion, and I think it's finally reaching its head, and I think that you're going to see the best of us because everybody else then leaped over top of us and used these programs against us. You know, I think we just need each other. That's where I'm at on it.
Okay, Jay. Appreciate you, man.
I agree.
Diane, you on air.
Yeah, excuse me. Good morning to everyone. I agree with them. How you doing? Hey, Dwight, how you doing?
I'm fine, thank you.
You're welcome. You know what? If you look at this, the way it is, and the affirmative action, you know, we have moved so far away. Do we teach our children about affirmative action? We don't have to do it all about in school, but back in the day, the churches used to do a whole lot for black people, educate us on the different things. And I heard somebody talk about voting. A lot of people that come in to vote don't know the issues. They just got the little card that says vote for this or that. But we don't break it down anymore to understand, like, I think one of the calls said, being a collective. If we vote in collective, we would get what we really need in America and in this state of Maryland. But we don't. We vote as a silo. Maybe my family, we might vote this way, or maybe my family and I don't vote the same way, you know. But we need to be collective when we do doing stuff concerning voting, concerning anything, even with housing coming in our community, different things coming in our community. We need to be a collective and not being an individual.
Okay.
I agree.
Thank you, Diane. Going to Mike, Robert, and Mac. Mike, you're on air. Mike?
Hey, good morning, Carlton. Good morning, panel. Mr. Pettit.
Hey, Mike.
Hey, how you doing, man? Similar to the other two callers. Now, I'm going to make it real brief. In every facet of history, black history, every time we have made some social and economic gains, they have squashed it. And when affirmative action got cut yesterday, all it means is that we have to prepare our children better. You're going to have to score better than you've had to score before. Just like Don said, our churches used to do things. They don't do them anymore. Our HBCUs, we are our own detriment. Now, white people have some fault, but I keep telling y'all, when Trump told them make America great, it meant that we're going to make America the way it used to be when you had preference for jobs, where you had preference for schools, where you had preference for housing. They are going to make it hard for us from here on out. And that's my comment. It ain't going to be easy. If you want easy, keep on crying. Keep on not voting. But you're just going to be crying. You better prepare your children because it's going to be hard from now on.
Thank you, Jane. Mac, you're on air. Mac, you're on air.
Hey, how y'all doing? I'm just want to reference something that Mr. Dashiell said. It's time for us to be truthful. So my point is, for that person that called up, if a person calls on the show referencing Darren Muhammad is one of the biggest Trump supporters. He has to be getting paid by the GOP. He another Armstrong Williams, and that's all I got to say. Man, yeah, thank you. Have a nice weekend.
You're welcome. Robert, last call for today.
Good morning. Thank you everyone for being here. I have a question. What the decision is, are the Asian and other people going to be able to come more to our black colleges than historical black people?
Now you're getting to the point.
Yeah.
First of all, the suit wasn't brought by Asians. Asians were used as the name plaintiffs. It was sponsored by white organizations. That's number one.
Yeah.
Secondly.
And Bob, tell him, because you looked it up for us, tell him the number of black law schools that are in the country right now. What was it, six?
No, I think you said seven.
Seven?
Yeah, but I looked it up. I think the number is six, according to Google. I don't necessarily know them all. But this decision to me means, and I believe it's therapeutic adversity. We have to now focus upon the institutions that are ours, and we have to make sure they remain ours. That means we've never said to anybody attending a black school that you're excluded because you're Asian or because you're white or because you're short, tall, or Jew. We never had that policy because they always had their first choice was never to come to our schools. So we never had the floodgates. Now, if you look at what's going on at many of the black schools, the minority scholarships are going to non-minorities. If you look at the population at a number of the black schools, the complexion is changing almost overnight. So if we lose our black schools as an institution within our community, we've already lost so many others. We lost our businesses. We lost Wall Street. If we lose control of a higher education, then we're going to lose. And the other important decision about the court refusing to allow Biden or to allow the country to abate the tremendous amount of debt associated with higher education. The fact of the matter is that's what kills the intellectual properties for the most of our community. Because our kids, by the time they get out of debt, they're already 55 and 60 years old. They got nothing left to give to anybody. They're still trying to at 65, they're still trying to start out in life in the absence of debt. We've got to stop that anyway. We got to, as Tehma like to say, we got to be more financially literate. We've got to find ways of getting education without incurring that kind of debt if we really want
to
be.
And so, we can, and there's a lot of opportunities out there, but we just have to encourage our kids to go the smarter way and not the glamorous way. And, you know, you don't always have to jump out into a four-year university and live on campus and then end up in $80,000 debt. You know, you can get the same type of education, same type of future in a different way.
Final thoughts, Dwight.
I want you to take this Tebbit home. Mm-hmm. Affirmative action started as an economic plan. The Philadelphia plan that Richard Nixon put out, the plan that Johnson put out, the plan that Kennedy put out. It was all about employment. First, employment in the federal government. And then, Bob, as you would know, being in employment, the money was supposed to move to the black community and businesses. It was about 8A, the 8A program, and starting and creating economic strength in the black community. They chipped away at that to the point that all we're talking about now is inclusion just in terms of race is a relationship to education. That wasn't the original version of affirmative action. I was there. I made the loans to Marion Barry and all the corporations that were created and businesses in the D.C., Montgomery County, PG County area. And that was about economics.
Yep.
They dwindled it down to education.
Dwight, final thoughts.
That was it.
Well, we appreciate
it. We have to come together as a coalition and political power, and we have to, in fact, if we have to lead the coalition, then we have to lead it. If we have to chastise people who do not do the right thing, as you were just talking about the Asian in terms of who brought this suit, we have to then chastise them. But we have to bring our core mobilization and energy that we had in the 70s and 80s because the right wing is fired up and they got the leader that they wanted, Trump.
Well, Dwight, we certainly thank you for taking time from your busy schedule to be with us again, breath of fresh air. We love you, respect you. Anytime that you want to call in on us with something up, you're welcome to do that. And, of course, I'll be looking for you, if possible, to be back with me next week on the other show. Okay?
Stay strong.
And I love you guys, too. Stay strong. Bob and I go way back, one of the great lawyers of this nation.
I call him the dean. And give my love to Barbara again.
All right.
Okay. All right.
Thanks for joining us.
Want to get you guys' view on this situation that came through locally about him putting in an interim DPW and the fact that the NAACP feels that they ought to have a nationwide search for commissioner.
A DPW interim? I think we had enough time in advance to do a search so that we wouldn't need an interim. Because
that's what I thought, too.
Position was going to be open and available. So I don't know what the need for an interim is. When it comes to Commissioner Harrison, he left. We have someone who is an interim who is on slate to be the permanent. We want someone to be homegrown. That's what I've been hearing throughout, you know, recent conversations. So I don't see a need to call for a nationwide search. Once he becomes in position, the mayor said that he will go around and talk to different communities and get their involvement at that time. So I think for the most part, all bases have been covered.
By the way, front page of the Sun is saying Harrison is still getting paid and so is Worley. And we ain't got no answers on that yet. Go ahead, Bob.
Well, the deputy director is not new. He's been there all along, and I'm not sure making him change his title from deputy director to acting director changes really anything.
With DPW?
Yeah, in terms of how DPW is going to be operated on a day-to-day basis. I think the NAACP somebody drank too much of the Kool-Aid. The notion that somehow or another you can't hire somebody as a police chief or any other position unless you've conducted a nationwide search. Well, why not a global search? Why not a search? Not a search in North America. The fact of the matter is, the selection is based upon the criteria established by those making the selection. And also, you got to remember, these are political appointees that serve at the pleasure of the mayor. Who you know, you're talking about somebody who political pundits say may not have a job himself within the next year and a half or so. So who's going to want to work for him? What qualified person is going to leave a position which they have and have security to go work, take a job that they might be out of in 18 months anyway?
And plus, we don't do a nationwide search for the mayor, which is like the number one position in the city. So
Okay.
Two quick announcements. First of all, I want to thank everybody that supported the fish fry at Gillis last week. We sold out, and it helped us immensely with our men's day. We want to thank you for that. Go ahead, Bob.
No, I called to try to get some because I didn't know whether it was inside. You said it was inside out. The rain part of the day.
Yeah, it was out and in because when it rained, they had to go in.
I called. Nobody answered the phone because I didn't know whether.
Oh,
the
okay.
Conductor,
I wish you had called me.
They were frying fish.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. They can't answer the phone. They frying fish.
Also, next weekend is big. The Caribbean Carnival Festival at Drew Hill Park. And the Crab Feast by the House of Prayer. And if y'all want tickets, you call Robin Oliver at 410-493-2211. That's Robin Oliver at 410-493-2211. I got a table already if y'all want to get in on this because the food is good. They do their own food, so there ain't no brought-in food and stuff like that, you know. Every Friday that all of us could get here is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. and Al Show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. We're glad you're listening. We hope you keep on listening. A lot to talk about. I guess most of the decisions of the Supreme Court are in or going to be in by today. So keep your ears open and your eyes open. Okay? As always say, take your head with your ear. Put it to the ground. Listen to the grass grow. See ya. Don't want to be ya. Bye.